morning. Summer has officially arrived with the heat, which means we'll probably get snow next week.
That's why everybody else is doing it.
It's very crazy. It went from this sort of nice springish type weather, all of a sudden, boom, up to the 90s. Hope this isn't a precursor for the rest of summer. I like the sunshine, but not the heat. Okay, we're going to be getting going in Galatians here this morning. As much commentary as it was, as you guys can provide, that means I can talk less. When we change from not having a guest speaker today, we forgot to take a look. Usually I don't do sound thinking when I'm, because on Sunday mornings to the teaching class, but we forgot to get that switched. So you get one of my last second Brian's text to remind me. Oh, 9 o'clock last night. Take through the files. Oh, there's one from over a year ago. It's on the main list. So if you get tired of me being up here, I'm sorry. And Steve, you can hold your tongue on that one. Oh.
I'm just going to say, we'll live.
You'll live, okay. Do you want to... I'm sorry?
Better you than me.
Better me than you. Okay, we do want to get started this morning, and since I'm talking with you, Steve, would you mind leading us in prayer?
Sure. Sorry. Holy Father in heaven, mighty God, thank you for this Lord's Day. We pray you'd be with all the folks that are sick, all those that are hurting and suffering in many ways. We pray for help for all of your saints in this world, and we know that we have it because you are our God. We don't know what will happen to us in this life, but we know there's a home waiting for us. We thank you for that. Please help Brad as we continue on in this study of Galatians. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Alrighty. Who can guess the questions I'm going to ask? Alright, let's do just a little review from last week and a little where we're going. Paul warns of some that trouble the Galatians. What were those troubling doing? Distorting, disproving, deluding, or demeaning? Very good, very good. It was distorting the gospel. And distorting, they're probably diluting it and demeaning it, but that's the word that is used in the scripture is distorting. I'm getting better, though. Arrows at my hips, a little Price is Right effect of thing going along there. Okay. Sort of a preview of what's going to be coming after the main part of the lesson this morning. A little foreshadowing. Where did Paul go first after his first visit to Damascus? Asia, Achaia, Armenia, or Arabia?
Arabia.
Very good. It was Arabia. So that's where we're heading. After we talk about a few other verses here, specifically, we're going to be looking at verse 10 that we're going to be focusing on this morning. So one verse focus that we're going to be taking off on. We then get into Paul's defense of his apostleship. Because those who were coming in as false teachers, those who were distorting the gospel, were saying, what about Paul? We're going to see later, it says in Galatians, but what were they basically saying about Paul? He's not really an apostle. He doesn't have the authority. He's just getting that from the other apostles. He didn't get, and so he's going to have to defend his faith. I mentioned this last week. Who do we seek to please or serve? What do you think? I mean, day-to-day life, Who are some people you seek to please or who you serve? Yeah, Wayne's got it right.
I'm sitting next to him.
Do we seek to please and serve our spouses? Mm-hmm. Hopefully. Ed? Oh, I forgot to turn my thing on. It's probably on purpose. So. Who do we seek to please or serve?
Ourselves.
I thought, Ed, that's what you were talking about, your point. He was tapping his chest back there. Is that it? Who else do we sometimes seek to please or serve?
Those in lines of authority.
I'm sorry, Jeff?
Those in lines of authority, your boss, the government.
Those who have authority over us. Our boss, our government.
Parents.
Friends. Friend?
But if you flip it over to the spiritual side, hopefully we're trying to please God.
And Paul's really beginning his defense here as we look at verse 10. They're accusing him of, he's getting his, what he preaches, what he teaches. They're saying, oh, he gets it from other people. But what does he say in verse 10 of Galatians chapter 1? For am I now seeking the approval of men, of man, or of God? Or am I trying to please man? From what we know of Paul, was he trying to please men? Because as we looked at, when roughly, and it's a wide area because we don't know exactly when, but when approximately was Galatians written? Somewhere in there, which was, in terms of what Paul did, were what was going on. He was either in the middle of the second missionary journey or was perhaps during the third or after the third. So it was there. What had Paul gone through, especially in the area of Galatia? What had he endured?
Stoning,
especially in the area of Lystra, Derbe, right? And other places, right? Could anyone accuse Paul of trying to serve man, in other words, get along and not cause waves? So, no. There's nothing to that. So as he asks this, am I now seeing the approval of man or of God? What can the Galatians say? This is what we call that rhetorical question, right? Who was Paul trying to seek approval of, to please? Yeah, he was zealous for God, and he's going to get to that in his defense. He's always been zealous about trying to get what? God's approval, do things right, although he was mistaken earlier. Or am I trying to please man? Was Paul trying to please man? No. We see what? He had the disagreement with Barnabas, a guy whose, his very name means what? Encourager, right? He has an argument about John Mark. He's not trying to please man. If anybody can be pleased and made get along with, it would have been Barnabas. And we're going to see later in his defense here of talking about that he's not going along these lines, is who does he say he reproves? Peter. He actually reproves Peter for hypocrisy. He's not trying to please people. He's got a whole bunch of Jews all over Asia and Achaia upset. He's not trying to please people, right? He's not trying to please man. Now, on that, and I'm not going to have a verse there, what does the scripture say about our getting along with people? No, but in as much as it's within our control, paraphrases, try to get along, right? If it's under your control. A lot of it's not.
Another one is to show perfect courtesy to all.
Yeah, showing perfect courtesy.
Or,
That's a hard one. But even that, that means it doesn't mean necessarily you're going to get along. Because as we preach the gospel and stay true to it, no matter what you do, some people are going to get upset. And he says, and he gives the argument, if I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ. In raising kids, is it easier to try to please them or to discipline them for their own good? It's easier to just appease them, right? Just appease, give them what they want, keep them quiet, right? But raising properly means what? Hard decisions, hard discussions, difficult situations arising, that we still stay through, true through. So we can't necessarily always, that's not the goal. And as Brian mentioned, what's the goal here? What's Paul indicating the goal is? Is to please God. His goal is, if I were trying to please man, I'm not going to be serving Christ. So my goal is to serve and please God. And that's his goal. And that's what I want to take a look at. Just sort of take that question this morning. Maybe this should have been a sermon rather than a class. I don't know. But are we seeking God's or man's approval? How many of us can say 24/7 that we always seek God's approval? I have to hold my hand behind my back. Right, but isn't that what we need to strive for? Isn't that what Paul was talking about? So I want to take a look at a number of verses that talk about this difference between man pleasing God, serving man, serving God. So we'll go through a few here. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. If you want to turn there with me. The point here is at the end of, towards the end of verse 9, but we're going to start in verse 8. By the way, this goes to show that power of, and I know the original language doesn't have punctuation, but in the English, when they put it in commas, the power of the comma, because if you have this first verse, the beginning of verse 8, if you have the comma in the wrong place, it sounds bad. It says, we do not want you to be ignorant, brothers, or if you put the, don't have the comma there, if we do not want you ignorant, brothers. It sort of sounds badly, but it says, we don't want you to be ignorant. In other words, what? Learn, right? We want you to learn. We want you to know. Do not want you to be ignorant, brothers, of the affliction we experienced in Asia. We're not hiding it. For we were so utterly burdened beyond our strength that we despaired of life itself. How many of us have ever been in that situation? Can't say I have. What was it? BJ's Egyptian friend. They came and spoke to us some years ago. Toddy. What was his name again?
Toddy.
None of us know what that's like, right? Because in becoming a Christian and trying to serve God, what did he incur upon himself?
Lots of wrath.
Death threats. If he showed his face to his family, they might have had him killed. And that's nothing, and that's probably not, it's getting closer, but that's not what Paul was enduring, was he? Oh, that's in, I thought you were raising your hand there, Paul, for a second. So he says, we were despairing. What? When Paul came into Corinth, and this is why he mentions this the first time, was he with people or was he by himself? Going back, if you remember a few weeks ago, Ed's missionary journey thing lesson. It was the second missionary journey. He comes into Corinth, but did he have support or was he alone? He was alone. He had sent Timothy off doing something else or left him behind. He was there, and what it says, he was fearful, right? Because he was alone. He didn't have support. He was in the new city. People had been following him, trying and persecuting him, trying to do him harm, right? And what was it? God eventually came to him in a message saying what? Don't be afraid. That's the kind of fear that he was feeling, that despair, right? Why am I even doing this anymore? Paul was not perfect. He had those feelings, right? Have you ever had that feeling? It's like, am I really doing what's the point? Sometimes. We're human, right? We feel that way sometimes. So sentence of death. He says, indeed, we felt we had received the sentence of death, but that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. What is suffering and trials supposed to make us look towards? Relying on God, seeking his approval, seeking to do his will. God, not man, not ourselves. Paul has many of these in Philippians 3. He begins talking about false teachers to the Philippians as well. He says in verse 1, finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you is no trouble to me, and it is safe for you. It's a verse I try to keep in mind when I'm teaching class. Not this class, but school. Because I seem to repeat myself a lot. That's probably for their good. Verse 2, look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh. For we are the real circumcision who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. In other words, where is our confidence to be? With God, not man. You guys probably know this one. Luke 18. Verses 9 through 14, Jesus is telling a parable, and he begins, two men went up into the temple to pray. What's that about? Yeah, well, what happens?
One of them is self-righteous.
And what was he saying?
I thank you, God, that bless me so much, and I'm not like this scumbag over here.
So where was that Pharisee's confidence? And what he was seeking to prove himself and the Pharisees, right? And the other one that the Pharisee was pointing to, what was his only prayer?
Humility.
It was that of humility. He wouldn't even look to raise up his eyes to the heavens, but beat his breast saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Who was he relying on and trying to please? God. It's constant throughout here. Paul's doing it, Jesus did it. Don't rely on yourself or a man or whatever. Don't try to please man or other people. Look to me. This one we know fairly well too, Matthew 6:24. This is in, what's the context here? What's Jesus doing? Sermon on the Mount. And he's teaching them lots of different lessons. Verse 22 and 23, he's talking about the eye is a lamp, and if your eye is bad, you be and need to follow the light, not have darkness. Verse 24 says, no one can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money, which the money represents what? The world, mankind, man. You can't serve both. How many of us have tried to serve both? It's all too often, probably, for myself. Romans 12. We know this one fairly well, too. Many of us have this memorized. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to what? Present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is the same word as what's mentioned as pleasing in Galatians. Holy and pleasing to God, which is your spiritual worship. I just put an equal sign between pleasing God and worship. How do we please God? What did you say? Present our bodies as a living sacrifice. Devoted, and what's a sacrifice in their context? Something that is dedicated or devoted to God. Jesus had to chastise the Pharisees because they were trying to get out taking care of their parents by declaring things Corban, that is devoted to God, which in itself is not bad, but they were getting out of doing their loving duty in trying to do that. It was for the wrong reasons. So what did he say? So being devoted to God, that living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which means trying to do what God wants, is our spiritual worship. That's what pleases him. So that's the positive, right? Serve God, be devoted to God. Is that easy to do all the time? No. We all get tripped up. 1 John talks about what? If we say we have no sin, we are liars. And the truth is not in us. But verse 2 then, and we've heard many lessons in this, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. That's the same thing that's what Paul's been doing, isn't it? He's been trying to discern the will of God, do God's will, what God wants as much as he can, as often as he can, being transformed, not conformed. Is it so easy to conform? We've done many lesson studies on that, about those words conform and transform kind of things. But it's so easy to... Is it easy to please men? To please man? To go along with the world? Oh, yeah. Dress the same, act the same, blah, blah, blah. Many people who don't support some of the social issues that get put out there still go along with it, right? Why? Just it's easy, right? They don't want the fight. Do not be conformed, but be transformed. Using what? The word, right? That's what it is. So that was, who do we seek to please, sir? But what is it that does please God? We just sort of hinted at that with Romans 12. What pleases God? If that's our goal, okay, I want to be pleasing to God, Jesus. What pleases him? Well, we just saw that in Romans 12. What is that worship? Being a living sacrifice, devoting our lives to God. I saw a hand. I thought. If we love him, we keep his commandments. Yes. Let's go to one that uses that word pleases very well. This is one that if you were a young person at Marcus Street when I was going through and my father taught the middle school classes, he had his list of memory verses, and this was one of them. Many of us have this memorized. What does Hebrews 11:6 say? Without faith, it is impossible to please him. We got to have faith. And of course, Hebrews 11:1, where does faith come from? Faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of God, right? Without faith, so that's the first number. You got to have faith, right? What does 1 Peter say on that list when he lists the virtues, right? The different add, supply in your, what's the first thing? Faith. That's where it's got to start, right? Got to have faith. 1 Thessalonians. He's talking to the Thessalonians about how he had been mistreated by not the brethren, but the people at the city of Philippi. And after all, that's where what happened to Paul in Philippi when he first got there? Fairly soon. We had the story of the conversion of the Philippian jailer. So he was thrown in jail in Philippi, right? He and who was with Silas, right? So they were shamefully treated at Philippi. That's what he's talking about. As you know, we had boldness in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in the midst of much conflict. For our appeal does not spring from error or impunity or any attempt to deceive. But just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak, not to please man, but to please God who tests our hearts. So in our faith, when we speak, our goal is what? Not to please any single person, but to please God. And we could go into a whole lesson on how should we speak, right? Let your speech be seasoned with salt, be graceful, right? And loving and kindness and so forth and all those different things. But that's one thing is, what does James say? James says what? If we, any man who can tame the tongue, right, is perfect. This is the speech, our words, is one of those things where we oftentimes fall down. Someone says something, you just react out of pride or anger or something, you say something wrong. So have faith, speak well. Walk in that faith. 2 Corinthians 5. Oh, lost my tab. Highlighting verses 9 and 10. But I'm going to go back to verse 6. But we are always of good courage. While we know that while at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. Excuse me. For we walk by faith and not by sight. What's that saying right there? Follow God, not man. Right? Walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we are of good courage, and we'd rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. So it's that walking by faith. That's what he said up there in verse 7. For we walk by faith and not by sight. That's our aim. That's the goal. You got to have that as a goal to begin with. If you don't have pleasing God as your goal, are you going to do it? I mean, if you take a trip and you don't have a goal, do you end up where you want to be necessarily? Well, it's, you got to have a goal if you know when it, where you want to end up. Excuse me. Colossians, this is, again, the more I prepare these lessons and the more I study, the more I find that, oh, this stuff is all throughout the entire scriptures, and it's all intertwined, and these themes you just find, again, just like love from John, love, 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 God, 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 not man, not man, right, it's everywhere. Colossians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10. And so he says, and so from the day we heard, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him. So it's got to be that walk, right? So it's faith, speech, it's the goal. And what's the walk? What does it mean by the walk? Life.
Yeah, what she said. The way we conduct our life.
And is it just parts of our life? It's everywhere we go. I mean, what did God promise Abraham as far as the land? What was the land promise?
Wherever his foot
steps, right? Wherever his walk took him, that would be his land. Actually belonged to his descendants, right? It was a promise. It's not just the New Testament. Let's go to the Old Testament. It's a longer book. I would love to do a study through Ezekiel, but I'm not studied enough on it to perhaps lead that class. So Ezekiel is rich in a lot of stuff. Ezekiel chapter 33. This is talking about his responsibility as a watchman, as the chapter heading put there by men says. And in verse 10 he says, and you, son of man, that's what? Who's son of man? Us, right? Say to the house of Israel, thus you have said, surely our transgressions and our sins are upon us, and we rot away because of them. How then can we live? Say to them, as I live, declares the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked. I just stopped there, a little side note. I'm trying to be like the Apostle Paul, take all these little side trips. What does the world like to paint, especially the worldly people of the world, what do they like to paint God as? What kind of being? Yeah, as a vengeful, just waiting for you to mess up so he can strike you down. And that's what the world wants to paint God as. What does Ezekiel say? No. God doesn't take pleasure in that. He says, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked. It doesn't make me happy. But that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn back and turn back from your evil ways, for why will you die, O house of Israel? That word pleasure, that's that pleasing. God is not pleased with having to punish the wicked. What does it say then he has pleasure in? What's the opposite of what he just said? Repentance. What was the story of Jonah? And if someone says whale, yeah, God wanted to send Jonah to Nineveh to get them to what?
Repent.
Repent.
And he was afraid they were great.
And God, just showing examples, there was prejudice and bias even back then. Because Jonah didn't like the Ninevite city. I don't want to go talk to them. So he tried to run away. Of course, we know what happens. So finally he, okay, Lord, I'll go do what you want. And even when he did it, was Jonah happy about it?
No.
But God sent Jonah there because as soon as Jonah preached, what did the Ninevites do? They repented. That's what God wants. What's the story of the prodigal son? There's a couple of themes. One is repentance. What? The son went away, righteous living, if that's a good word. Finally realized how lost he was when he was destitute and feeding the pigs. And came back. And what was the what does it say the father was doing when the son was coming back? Looking for him daily, right? Every day. Wanting what? Looking for, longing for his child to repent and come back. That pleases God. How many of us sometimes when we've messed up go, oh, man, God must really hate me. Have we done that? Yeah. But does he hate us? No. When we mess up, what does he want us to do? Repent, confess it to him, he'll forgive us, and come back. That makes him happy. That pleases him, gives him pleasure. That's what Ezekiel's saying here. Now, of course, we got to then marry that with Romans 6. And what does Romans 6:1 say? Paul goes to the Romans, what? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Let's go sin and come back so we can make God happy. No. Paul says, no, heaven forbid. No, that's not the way it works. Let's go to Psalms 149. Let's turn my Bible upside down. I'm going to read not just verse 4. The focus is on verse 4, but we're going to read some of the others. Psalm 149, praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of the godly. Let Israel be glad in his maker. Let the children of Zion rejoice in their king. Let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with the tambourine and lyre. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with salvation. What pleases God? Humble service to him. Micah 6:8, one of my favorite verses I love to quote. What does God require of you, O man, but to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with our God? Because the humbleness means what? Just as Paul was saying, don't please myself, don't please man, but please God. God's the same today, yesterday and forever, right? It doesn't change. He hasn't changed. It's what he's always wanted. So what pleases God? So we'll just give a brief introduction here. Let's go back to Galatians. That was verse 10. One verse today. Woohoo! But that's at the core of so much what we do, isn't it? When I mess up, when I'm doing something wrong, when I get upset, probably 99 times out of 100, what's the cause? I'm trying to please me. So I can't get out of my own way sometimes, it seems. I'm glad my wife is being quiet about it. We all mess up. So he says in verse 11 then, I'm not trying to please man. The gospel I'm preaching to you, for I would have you know, brothers, that the gospel that was preached by me is not man's. He's going to the point. This is not about man. This is all about God. What he gave me was not man's gospel, but it's going to be God. It's not man's gospel. And that he received it from Jesus. For I did not, verse 12, for I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. Now we'll save it for next week. We're going to go through through Paul's life a little bit, as he does here in Galatians. Was Paul aware of the message of the gospel prior to Jesus appearing to him?
Yes.
Yeah, he was. Otherwise, why would he be persecuting it? He was aware of the message because at the time, while he was persecuting it, he thought these Christians were doing what? These Jewish Christians were blaspheming God. Right? Because Jesus, he's not the Son of God. And if Jesus wasn't the Son of God, would Saul of Tarsus have been right? The problem was Jesus was who he said he was. Paul just didn't know it. So he did know the message of the gospel. But did he have it fully revealed to him? Because what did the Holy Spirit do for the apostles prior to Saul?
He reminded them of everything Jesus had taught.
Yeah, brought to their remembrance everything, right, that was taught. Gave them the revelation of the Word of God. Now that Paul did not have. He knew what the message was, but he did not have that revelation. And as far as we can tell from the scriptures, had Paul had any interaction with the apostles prior to his trip to Damascus? We don't know is the best answer, but scriptures sort of don't say it. It shows that Saul had some connection to Stephen, right? At the stone of Stephen. Could he have interacted with the apostles around that time? Maybe, but we don't have confirmation of that. So he said, I didn't get the revelation from man. And we're going to see later, I didn't talk to any of the apostles. I got it from God. And we're about out of time, so we'll leave it there. Paul got this direct. And as a closing thing, because we're not going to be talking about it next week, the world sometimes likes to, there's people in the world sometimes they say, I know I'm saved because an angel appeared to me or God appeared to me. When was Paul saved?
When he was baptized.
Was that when Jesus appeared to him?
No.
Most people in the world would say, but Jesus appeared to Paul, he's saved. No. He went into Damascus. A day or two later, then what? Who was it that came to him? Ananias, and told him what? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins. Paul was still in his sins. Jesus had appeared to him, but Paul was still in his sins. Doesn't, right? There are certain things you got to go through. It's a good one to use with people of the world. I had a discussion with a coworker during the year, and we were talking about different stuff. Baptism, and I just put him to the question. I didn't answer it for him. I told him to go look it up. When was Paul saved? When Jesus appeared to him or later? Anyway, oh, that's a good question. So, one of those things to bring up. Thank you very much. And that's it for this morning.